Hey everyone, Laurel here today with an expert level data sufficiency question from the GMAT. So before we work on this together, go ahead and pause the video, take a couple minutes, and try this question out on your own. So the very first thing I want to do on a data sufficiency question, especially if it looks like it's going to be on the challenging side, which this one is to really understand what the question is asking. And in this case, I am told that a university badminton club has both students and professors. And I am asked if the number of students is at least 45. And so I just want to make sure that I have that written down, if there are at least 45 students. And then I can go ahead and move on here. And one other thing I want to take a quick note of is just, okay, this is data sufficiency. What kind of information am I looking for? Well, certainly if I am told the number of students, that's going to be sufficient. Also, if I know something about the professors and the club, that could be enough to figure out the number of students. And so I'm sort of keeping my options open for what the GMAT might be giving me in this statement. There are a lot of different things here that could turn out to be sufficient. So let's go ahead and jump into the first statement, which tells me that the number of professors is a multiple of 8. So This seems pretty insufficient to me, but I am just going to really quickly try some numbers out. So if I have, for example, 8 professors, I ultimately want to know if I have at least 45 students. And so I could have, for example, 1 student, or I could have 16 professors and 300 students. And so in one case, no, in the other case, yes, that means this is insufficient. And I can go ahead and eliminate answer choice A and answer choice D. Great. And now I'm ready to jump into statement 2, which tells me that the number of students is exactly 20% greater than the number of professors in the club. And so to write that algebraically, that looks like students being 1.2 professors. And again here, this seems insufficient because there are a lot of different options, but I am going to go ahead and test some cases out. So let's say I now have 10 professors. That would mean that I have 12 students. But if I have 100 professors, I have 120 students. And so I have two different answers here. Now, I want to pause here and point something else out. And this I was clued into starting at statement 1 when the GMAT told me that the number of professors was a multiple of 8. That clues me into that we might be thinking about divisibility here. And as I move into statement 2, you can see that I had sort of like an unconscious bias toward picking 10 and 100 because they were very easy to take 20% of. Well, what if I were to pick something like 12 professors and try and discover the number of students here? Well, when I take 20% of that, that's actually going to give me 14.4 students. And now I see something very important, which is that this question has what is called a hidden integer constraint. We cannot have 4/10 of a student or a professor. And so I actually am going to make a note here that both P and S must be integers. They also, by the way, must be positive because we cannot, just like we can't have 4/10 of a student, we can't have a negative student. We can have a negative student attitude, but we can't have a negative student. So in this case, what's going to actually happen here is that we have to have a number that we can cleanly take a fifth of. And that means that it's going to have to be a number that is divisible by 5. And to show you what's happening here, when I say, for example, that my professors were 10, the way I take the students is I do 20 additional percent of it. So I do 10 plus 20% of 10 another way to write this is 1/5 of 10. And you can see that in this case, it would simplify to 2, and I would then come up with 12 students. So now I'm ready to combine these two facts, the facts that the professor has to be a multiple of 8 and a multiple of 5. Whenever I combine statements, I like to rewrite them because that ensures that I'm keeping track of everything and I'm combining it well and I'm not missing anything. And so in this case, 1 and 2 combined tells me that the professor's is a multiple of 8 and a multiple of 5. Okay. So let's go ahead and make our chart again, and we are asking ourselves if students are greater than or equal to 45. And we can see that in this case, if we start with something like 8, it's actually not a legal case. It's not a multiple of 5. If we were to take 8 and try and find 20 additional percent of that, we would do the same thing over here, except that now we would have 8. And as soon as we try and do that, we wind up with looking for something that is 1/5 of 8, which is 8/5, which is not an integer, and so it's not valid. So actually the very first number that's legal as a case here, which is a multiple of both 8 and 5, is 40. And if I have 40 professors, then I have 48 students. If I have 80 professors, then I have 96 students. And in both of these cases, actually, the students are indeed gonna be greater than or equal to 45. And so now once I've combined both of these pieces of information, I can see in fact that this is sufficient, and I'm able to go ahead and select the correct answer here, which is C. So a lot going on there. A couple things I wanna encourage you to do is, first of all, to rephrase the question stem. As soon as you see it, it's really important to get in there and figure out what's going on. Here it was pretty clear once we wrote it down, but often it can be really confusing. And then the other thing is to just keep an eye out for what's the theme here. So some students might be tempted to just write down like 8 and 16 and 24 and try every single multiple of 8, but I really want to encourage you to stop and say, well, what's happening here? Why is it working sometimes and not others? And in this case, it's that trick about it has to be a multiple of 5. Thanks for watching. Subscribe for more GMAT Math Spotlight videos from Manhattan Prep, and leave us a comment telling us how you solved this question. Happy studying!